meet Michael Archer and one of his dogs. Now, Michael is a vertebrate paleontologist at the University of New South Wales, and he likes talking about this: how we'll resurrect the gastric brooding frog and the Tasmanian tiger. Have a look at that TED talk. He's obsessed with bringing back an extinct animal called the thylacine, or the Tasmanian tiger. Here's what they look like. And it went extinct. You can see the tiger's stripes on this thing, and that's why it's called a tiger. And you can see why it went extinct, because the farmers didn't like the Tasmanian tiger stealing all of its chickens. But we can bring it back by using DNA. Now, he's also a writer of books, and he's written about the mammals of Australia and New Guinea, about the Riversley site, where digging up a lot of old crocodiles in Queensland, and then about vertebrate zoology and evolution of Australasia. Now, I sat down with Michael in his lovely house in Sydney, and we talked all things mammalogy, human intelligence, and the question, are we alone?
I'm Michael Archer, professor of biological science at the University of New South Wales.
And Michael, are we alone in the universe?
Of course we're not alone, Charlie. The universe is filled with life. The question is, are we alone in terms of being sentient life in the universe? And about that, I'm not so sure.
Do you think that anything like human-like intelligence would evolve again?
No, not on Earth. Not the one-shot kind of arrangement. You're just taking all the players off the table, but you got the same dice to start with, the organic dice, and you chuck them out. Are you going to end up with the same outcome?
Not the same. So some people think that there is a human-like intelligence niche.
I don't think there's a chance of that, frankly. Okay, I think we're talking about a miraculous improbability to achieve the kind of sentience that we've got, because it doesn't have function, or it's just marginally functional. And in fact, you'd have to ask the question, if we've only been on this planet as a sentient species for about 300,000 years, this is a very early stage in a very bizarre biological experiment, and there's no guarantee it's going to have any utility or any future.
No.
Or any future viability. Beanie, cut it out. Now, see, that's why. I mean, here is an advanced mammal, this dog, it's 40 million years of mammalian evolution going into building brains that can outwit the herbivorous species that it wants to eat. And you can't have a conversation with a dog. I'll pick my dog up so you get continuity of that little event. Here, Noodles, come here. Are you ready? I think it's our presumption that somehow we are the epitome of what life should become, and that all these other potential outcomes are you know, not things we're really thinking about. It could have happened in many different ways.
Well, what do you mean by life?
Any substance, basically, that can be put into the right context and that can then produce products of the kind that we regard to be the stuff of living tissues is alive. A fragment of DNA, if put into a genome and it works and produces a product, it produces proteins, is alive. A kidney stripped out of a guy who's dead on the road for 5 days, and the kidney works, it actually works in somebody else. The guy's technically dead, legally, but his kidney was fine, and it's going to help somebody else stay alive.
Well, this is what Carl Sagan said. He said, humans are the universe's way to become conscious of itself. What do you think of that?
Yeah, it's a cute idea. On the other hand, it sort of ascribes to the universe the need to have an intelligent perception of itself. And of course, that's a very human kind of an idea. I think the universe couldn't, frankly, even if it could, give a shit about us or about whether we're here or not.
All right, how about advice for students?
Advice for students, the biggest and best bit of advice I can give to any student is never let any old fart professor tell you what can't be done. Never.